after the first presidential, so-called presidential debate, which is already nobody can remember anymore. We are down the drain now. I came across a Russian commentator, and he commented on political processes and all sorts of things. And I found it so apropos that I brought it in, and I want you to guess who it is, okay? And if you can guess where it's from, I will bring you next time, I didn't have time to buy a big Lindt chocolate bar, okay? So this is what this commentator had to say. In all affairs of this kind, certain people will always make their appearance. They are hot-headed men, eager for justice, and quite simply and honestly convinced that justice is inevitable. Inevitably, invariably, and above all, immediately possible. They are not more stupid than other people, and some of them are even very clever, but they are too passionate to be cunning and calculating. However, they nearly always lose their cause because of their hot-headedness, but their hot-headedness gives them their influence over the masses. Men follow them willingly. Their ardor and honest indignation impress everybody, and the most irresolute join them in the end. Their blind confidence in success seduces even the most hardened skeptics, although sometimes that confidence has such shaky and infantile foundations that it is a wonder to the disinterested onlooker that they are followed. The main thing is that they march in the van, is the vanguard, and that they advance without fear. They rush forward like bulls, horns down, often without understanding the matter, without heed, and without that practical casuistry by means of which the most debased and abject creature not infrequently wins his cause, gains his ends, and emerges unscathed from the struggle. But they must always come to grief. In everyday life, these people are peevish, irritable, touchy, and impatient. Very frequently, they are terribly limited, but this constitutes part of their strengths. The most vexatious things about them is that often, instead of making straight for their object, they allow themselves to be diverted and fling themselves on trifles instead of the important things. It is that which brings them to disaster, but the masses can understand them. This is their strength. Who is the writer? Right. Okay, the chocolate bar goes to the person who can locate that piece. Dostoevsky. Where did it appear? Chocolate bar is up for you. It's a big one. You would be nuts.
No, you've already promised it to her. She got the right author.
That's our good advice for the person who locates it. Okay, you'll get a small chocolate bar.
The thing is, I listened to this on tape, and I have to say, it sounded like some of the descriptions about some of the criminals. Like, the whole book is him just going into different times when he talks about different criminals he's housed with, and it sounded like one of the long descriptions, but I don't remember.
Okay, we're not talking about a criminal here. We're talking about a man who can fascinate the masses. You remember the chapter Grievances? Okay, where it's about community leaders, where it is about agitators. What is the fascination of agitators? You just have to go horns down, be like a bull, be hot-headed, and people will follow you. Don't ask this thing. I found it so apropos. That I had to bring it in because it is applicable for now. So, yes. Okay, small chocolate bar to the winner. And why don't you introduce yourself to everybody so we know who you are?
You or me?
You!
Oh, you are the... No. You are
I'm Karen Crystal.
So, Karen Crystal has won the Dostoevsky Prize for tonight. Wonderful. Okay, so today we are talking about four different writers. Please find a seat. They are very different guys. Ivan Turgenev, wealthy landowner. Fyodor Dostoevsky, son of an impoverished nobleman, son of a doctor. Nikolai Leskov, probably the only man who actually worked for a living, very poor. And Avram Gorikovna, whose fate you also know. I want to remind you of Maxim Gorky's Gomel. It is impossible to understand the history of Russia in the second half of the 19th century without knowledge of Saltykov's work. What we talked about when we talked about Saltykov, we started out with two writers who are very far apart from each other, never met each other in life, but had a common theme, which was the societies they were talking about were stuck. They were nothing, none of them was moving about. For Saltykov, our position was also, what happens when you live without a purpose? You are in utter misery, when you have no hope. The theme of hope, you remember, is a great theme in the memoirs of the House of the Dead. Prisoners cannot live without hope, and they cannot live without work. Here, too, is an inner connection to Saltykov. I was actually fascinated, I don't know if it was the same with you, as I was reading Dostoevsky right on the heels of Benjamin III, the chapter about spring. When you are in the second part, and of course it starts in December and we're moving into spring, what happens in the spring chapter? What was similar to Benjamin? What was the main theme in Benjamin?
Everybody wants to get out.
Go forth, young men. Go west, young men. Spring up. There's a wonderful connection here that when spring comes, people have to get out. The same kind of impulse that we actually saw in Abramovich. Kitchen gossip. Okay, the kitchen that they have, the bathroom that they have, very similar. Somebody said one of the favorite scenes for them was the oven. I think maybe it might even have been you. The oven where the community talks in Benjamin III. Here we have it in the kitchen. People come for kuchonia razgavori. They come for the kitchen talk. And the third scene that for me struck a chord was laughing at the Jew. Remember the last scene in Benjamin III? How Benjamin saves his neck and that of Senderel by making himself the laughing stock. And that really for today is the common denominator in the stories that we'll be reading, which is astounding. We have four different guys from very different, let's count this one out, although he also made himself the laughing stock. The three Russians from three different socioeconomic strata from three different environments, and yet they have the same image of the Jew. And we will have to see if it's ironic or if it's serious, what happens with it. We are also now moving into, so Omsk, about roughly here, Zhivaya Zhinya, Tomsk a little bit to the right, and Semipalatinsk, where Dostoevsky was living, a little bit to the south of Omsk, and of course, obviously, Moscow over here, and St. Petersburg a little bit further up. So you see, Omsk and Tomsk are really very far away. You should always have your maps with you, our maps here. This is Aryol, where Turgenev and Leskov were at home. So you see, very, very far away from the period of settlement. They had no contact with Jews whatsoever, never grew up with them, had nothing to do with them, except for Leskov, had one contact with Jews, which was when, do you remember, he left Vilna when he was 18, he got married when he was 18, he just toughed it out for 1 year, he disappeared, left his wife and his little baby, and went to Kiev, and in Kiev worked for one of the recruiting offices at the age when he was 18, so that would have been roughly 1877, and that would be the exact same time at which our Benjamin and Sandro would have shown up at this office. So somebody like Leskov, who was a nothing with very little education. I mean, he did get some education, but was not, how shall I say, a refined mensch, would be working in drafting the Jewish voice. And he felt very sorry for that in the rest of his life, and that actually showed, will show up in the stories when we talk about that. Now, a little bit before we move into the story, I want to get, I always put a little bit of teaching in it. So like God, Rabbi Gottes was said, he likes to, every Yom Kippur spell one word. This year it was T-I-D-Y, okay? So I always do a little bit of teaching for you. Okay, so in the Russian Empire in 1855, we have about, and I just showed you the map, how huge it was, all right? Which is 1/6 of the Earth's surface is the Russian Empire. So it's enormous. So in 1855, there lived 68 million people, of whom 800,000 can read. So when we are talking about the great Russian writers, we are talking about people who write for a very tiny sliver of society. And in their society, in the 1850s and 1860s, the major language spoken was French, not Russian. Leskov is one of the few 19th century Russian writers, older 19th century Russian writers, who actually grew up speaking Russian. Okay. In Russia, and I want Zhenya and Zhenya to always correct me if I say something that is not correct. The thinking in individuals is a very late phenomenon. People were thinking, the Russian government was thinking in groups. And it is completely pronounced so in the 18th and 19th century, which is what interests us Jews. People were assigned to a Sosloviet, which is an estate or a social group. There were only four of them. And every individual had to fit into one of those categories. Okay, so we have, and this is what Dostoevsky is so proud of, the dvoryanstva, say that right? Dvoryanstva, the lower gentry, and they make up 1% of the Russian population. Of that 1% of the Russian population, okay, only 50% of the men, so we're talking about a quarter of the people there, had more than a primary school education. I want you to really understand how thin the layer of intellectuals is at the time that we will be talking about. Then you have the kupechestvo, these are the submerging class, they are all sorted into guilds. It was a real privilege into guilds. It was a real privilege to belong to them. Jews tried to get to become part of the kupechestvo because it gave them certain privileges of traveling. It was really hard, it cost a lot of money, up to like 10,000 rubles, and not everybody had them. Then the meshchanstvo, these are the townspeople, usually the craftsmen. The Jews were sorted into the meshchanstvo because Catherine the Great, who started all of this, and who actually quiet, we talked about that Jews actually became part of the Russian Empire through the division of Poland in the late 18th century, wanted more people to be in towns because she needed a middle class. And even though the Jews were settling in the countryside, she decided that they needed to be in the towns. So when we have very often an expelling of the Jews from the countryside, they get crowded into the cities. When we are, if you would be reading, if we were reading, and if you will read eventually, Tevhid HaMilchika by Shlomo Aleichem, it ends with an expulsion. It is an expulsion. But it's not an expulsion from the country. It's an expulsion from the countryside into the city. And they happened very frequently as the Russian government decided that they didn't want to deal with the Jews in the countryside anymore for various problems. So then you had to be crammed. You had to leave the countryside. You had to go to the city and basically become a proletariat. And then the last one, so this is the Christianstvo, this is the peasantry, 80% of the population. Very important to remember, by 1861, that's one of the reasons really why Russia lost the Crimean War, you have 23 million serfs. What does this do to an economy if your major population that would be working in a factory, we're talking about the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, is not going where the money is and producing goods, but is stuck in the countryside. 23 million people. We're completely out of the loop, out of everything, couldn't be sent to the army. So Alexander II, who came in, his father died in 1855, Nikolai I, we talked about him, inherited this situation, and he was losing the war to the British, who had better machinery, better technology, better fighters. And he decided, not because he was a good guy and he was humanistic and all of that, but he decided that he had to modernize Russia. And Russia could only be modernized if it was beginning to generate a workforce. And the workforce could only come from the serfs that were 23 million people. And that is the great revolution. So as Alexander was coming in, and we're really today talking about the reign of Alexander from 1855 to his being murdered in 1881, as he comes in, he decides that he needs to break it to the landowners, that they need to be able to release the serfs. And to his great credit, to Turgenev, who owned many thousands of serfs, he was a wealthy landowner, a slaveholder, if you want, who left Russia in 1856, never to return except for short visits. He started the liberation process very early and paid his serfs a wage. And he calculated he lost about a quarter of his value, but that still left him with three quarters, so that's actually pretty good. So the liberation of the serfs is not part of a humanistic impulse by this Romanov. It is actually, it was an economic and necessity just in order to continue to be competitive in a European marketplace. I want to just remind you before we go straight to the Turgenev text, so you can get your text ready, four books that are really essential here. I want to remind you really of this fantastic book by, it's a little bit dark today, I don't know why that is, by John Doyle Clear, Imperial Russia's Jewish Question, 1855 to 1881. If you really want to know something about the rise of Judeophobia, which we're only going to be touching on a little bit today, that is the book to read. It deals with the very complex situation of laws against the Jews. The book that's not worth reading, unfortunately, is Elena Katz, Neither With Them Nor Without Them, Russian writer than the Jew in the Age of Realism, which deals with Dostoevsky and Turgenev. I found that very weak, so don't go for that one. Dostoevsky and the Jews, a classic. One of you has it. I offered one copy and one person bought it. So Dostoevsky and the Jews by David Goldstein is a basic book. It is excellent, a little bit outdated, but with very good observations about the growing Judeophobia in Dostoevsky. The essential book on Nikolai Leskov, who for me was the ultimate discovery. I love this writer, even though he too turned out to be an anti-Semite, but very refined, very witty, very practical, very real. And we will look at deception and we will see just how stunningly that is constructed. So there's only one biography in English. It's by Hugh MacLean, Nikolai Leskov, The Man and His Art. And then finally, for me, the great discovery in preparing for this course, a book that I absolutely loved. It comes in very small chapters. And if you want to walk around 19th century Russia and have tea with the Russian writers on a very high intellectual level, see how after Tolstoy was fighting in the Crimean War, and he was part of the siege of Sevastopol, he was in 1855 and Sevastopol fell and the war was almost over, he went to St. Petersburg, and for 1 month he lived with Turgenev, and he absolutely got on his nerves. Turgenev was 10 years older, and there is a wonderful description of just that, and many descriptions like that in this book, Russia in the Age of Alexander II, Tolstoy and Dostoevsky by Walter Moss. I really recommend it. And in the age of digital, it is online. At this website, not all of it, I think it's better to have the book, but write down, and actually I will post a slideshow, actually Eugenia will post a slideshow to Edmodo, and you will find this website. Go on it. plenty of pictures and really wonderful reading. Okay, we are back and we are about to start with Turgenev. Here is our man. He was already a bit older. He was living in France. I want you to take in this picture and just a little bit more about his background. So he studies as a very young man. So the first thing that you need to know about Turgenev, his mother was the spitting image of Alina Petrovna. Do you remember her from Saltykov? Do you remember her tyranny? You remember her abusiveness? Okay, square that and you have Turgenev's mother. He grew up in a horrible circumstances with a really sadistic mother. He had several brothers and one sister, two sisters and one brother. They were very close. And also somebody did not take care of the estate and left them completely hanging. So when she died, which was I think was in 1855, it was very difficult. An abusive, sadistic Arina Petrovna for mom. So that recalls Gorky's statement. Studies in Moscow, studies in St. Petersburg, and then, very important, goes to Berlin and studies with Hegel and falls in love with the German Enlightenment. And at that moment, he felt Russia could never catch up. Russia could only catch up and become a great modern nation at the very moment that it would embrace and not just embrace, but practice Enlightenment ideas. They for him sort of like stopped a little bit with the Jews, so that was also very complicated for him. He comes back after 3 years. Of course, he speaks fluent German, of course. He works for the Russian government, 2 years even in the interior ministry. And then, of course, St. Petersburg has a great opera life. He meets the French, actually originally Spanish opera singer, Pauline Viardot, and he falls desperately in love. And for the rest of his life, he will follow Pauline around and live in France, and it will become a ménage à trois. Whether consummated or not, we don't know. I think the first kiss was like 2 years later or something in Moscow. He writes about that. And important for us, and I'm very sorry actually that I did not assign this book because it turns out to be the key text, Gogol's Taras Bulba. We should have, so that the figure of Yankel the Jew is really the original of all the cliches that we are finding in the story. So he has, and this is what's key here when we're thinking about the image of the Jew that we'll now be looking at in about a minute. He helps Pauline Viardot, actually her husband Louis, to translate Taras Bulba into French. And in Taras Bulba you have the primary, the core image of Yankel the Jew, whom we will see in various versions in the different stories we'll be looking at. He leaves his job in Russia, and he then writes an essay about the importance of Gogol. He meets with Dostoevsky, who was beginning his career in St. Petersburg, and he writes The Jew. He goes back to his mother's house. Spaskoye is actually their estate. And in Spaskoye, he begins writing the sketches that sketches from A Hunter's Life or Hunter's Notebook. And this is really his first publication or his first significant assembly of stories. And simultaneously, and this story does not make it into his first collection, large collection of stories, The Hunter's Notebook, he writes The Jew. So he writes this story as he's already in love with Pauline Viardot. He is about to tell his mother that he will leave Russia forever and go and follow Pauline to the rest of Europe, who she lives in France, but she periodically comes to St. Petersburg to sing. And the censor is so outraged by this story that he will not release it for 1 year. So the other editor of Sovremenye, I think, for the contemporary, I think that was just revived. I think Sovremenye is the one, so the contemporary, this journal was just revived, had to pull every single string he could in order to get that story released. Now, this was not a pro-Jewish censor. Why was the censor so outraged by that story? why would he not release it for a year? So we have to think about that too. So, Elizabeth Pauline, read Taras Bulba, met Dostoevsky, will be about to leave Russia. Since enlightenment is the only element that can make Russia into a great nation. And then in 1847, he publishes that story anonymously. Okay, now, what does it all mean? Okay, so I want to say one more thing. So in 1867, Turgenev, Pauline Viardot bought herself a house in Baden-Baden, the city where I was born, right next to the casino. And Dostoevsky was a gambler. So Dostoevsky also comes. And of course he gambles, he is married, newly married, and the wife is also there, and she's already pregnant, and they have no money, and Dostoevsky goes and gambles, and he loses the money, and Turgenev gives him the money, and he goes back to the casino, and he loses the money, and Turgenev gives him more money. Okay, fine. And then finally said, okay, if you're going to take that money, you really got to go back to Russia now. And he goes back to Russia, but not before, of course, paying a nice visit, thank you visit to Turgenev, and he says, there are no people who are a greater, further part than Turgenev, the Enlightenment person, and the love of the Enlightenment, and Dostoevsky, the love of the narod, of the people. He declared to me, Turgenev declared to me, Dostoevsky, that he was an absolute atheist. He loathes Russia. His book Smoke annoyed me. He himself told me that had just actually appeared. He himself told me that the main argument of this book was contained in this phrase, if Russia were to disappear, there would be no loss or cause of excitement for mankind. He was a Germanophile who said, I regard myself as a German, not as a Russian, and I'm proud of this. You can just see Dostoevsky bristle. And yet, he had to be nice because, of course, he was in debt to him. And now, one more quote from a Jewish guy, Jewish reaction to that, by a man whom we will be reading a little bit later in this course. Zev Jabotinsky, Vladimir Jabotinsky, also read this story, and here's what he said. And then I will ask you about your reactions to the story and how can we open the story to us. The story is so far removed from life that it borders on naivete. Reading it, one can clearly see that the author had not actually observed anyone like him, this Jew. He simply could not have. He just made it all up, just as he had made up his fairy tales about ghosts. But what indeed had he made up? What feelings did he depict? And what colors did he use in painting his protagonist's portrait? The old Jew is certainly a spy. And as if this is not enough, the Jew also sells his daughter to the officers. The daughter, however, is a beauty. Clearly, this was simply a must. The author could not leave the unhappy tribe without a single asset. They should have had at least some goods to sell. Of course, irony, Jabotinsky. Okay. All right, the Jew. Johan, what did you make of this? What was your reaction? Can we save Turgenev? Can we save him from himself? Let me just get a few reactions from you, just when you read it. Were you sick to your stomach or upset?
I was amazed at what a perfect distillation it was of the anti-Semitic story. Mm-hmm. It reduced it to its like essentials.
It reduced it to its essentials. It was like out of a book, right? It was like, if you had to put all the cliches into a thing, that would be it. Okay. Right, were you upset? Did you expect this of this nice Turgenev? I just showed you a civilized man. How about the Enlightenment?
I wasn't shocked. I didn't know whether or not Turgenev was somehow out of step with his contemporaries in that respect. It turns out that he wasn't, which wasn't shocking.
He's not shocked. Okay, I was really upset. I told you I was really upset, and I had to dig and dig and dig until I figured out what was going on.
I've come to terms with the anti-Semitism of T.S. Eliot and Hemingway.
This is a different kind. Can I just have a few other reactions?
I can think of the parallels to the Purim story. That you had a uncle bringing his niece, in this case the father bringing his daughter to the courtyard.
Isn't that interesting? I didn't think of that. Yes, yes, yes. The uncle, the guy, the relative, the close male relative who prostitutes his daughter for money. Yeah, okay, so sex and money are always like intertwined. And okay, so yeah, we have a version of that too, which is why I hate porn. I can't take porn.
Except
porn
for
is disgusting. Should be abolished.
Yeah, except at the end.
Turned out a little differently.
Wrong guys ended
yeah,
up
okay,
on the couch.
All right. Yeah, oh, good, all right. All right, like a porn story. Okay, so sex and money is always like sort of like a grill. You can trade one for the other, okay? It's a father who prostitutes his child, sorta. But not really, because he's like hanging around the tent. It's like, remember the scene Deception? How do we know? Wasn't she instructed not to go further than that? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's only at the very end. It's really only at the very end. Under what circumstance is he really, he's not willing to do it really just for money. He wants to get the money out of
it.
He wants to trade her integrity, let's put it this way, for his life. At the very end, that is the killer and the end. Okay, that is where I think it gets to be really serious. Okay, Louise?
I was struck that your quotation touched upon something that puzzled me. In our everyday lives, children often resemble their parents, and yet these character portrayals completely dichotomize the father and the daughter. So
right.
That one is the
very
embodiment
good.
Of ugliness, and
that's
the other is
right.
possessed of beauty, and I was asking
and
myself,
beast.
Why would somebody structure their portrayal of this people that way? And normally a father is a protector of a daughter.
Right, because by the 18th century, what we are having here was a cliché already, it was a literary trope. Okay, the ugly father who has a beautiful daughter who's the Jewish, the exotic Jewish, the Orientalist studies, we get that. We have it.
Yeah.
It was all over the map in 18th century and early 19th century Europe. It was a teaching tool that was, especially in the Enlightenment, that was to teach tolerance to the reader. How is that accomplished here? And then we need to look a little bit closer at the beginning of the text.
Another thing was that the pathos of the daughter's situation and the whole narrative was so emotionally disturbing that I couldn't quite get it out of where Turgenev completely was in this. And from the very first paragraph where this fine, beloved Russian colonel is portrayed, my immediate reaction is to wonder whether Turgenev is being ironical about this.
Ah, very good, because we have to, because we are dealing with a cliché, and it is so thick, and it is so grotesque, that we need to figure out how we're being manipulated. We need to figure out what's the narrative situation here. Who is talking, what are the circumstances, what is being said, and what happens with you at the end. What happens if you're going through this story? What happens with you at the end? Were your feelings at the beginning the same as at the end?
No.
What happens to you in the middle somewhere, where at the end, or where something happens, because something does happen, right?
Okay. Do we know if the father was a spy, or was that planted?
No, the father was a spy. I mean, that's really, I actually looked at these maps. There are these maps of the camp. So this was an excerpt from a map. There were these maps of Danzig. So we are actually talking about 1813. So that's our first thing. We're talking about 1813, and we're talking about the French-Polish troops are sitting in the city of Danzig, Gdansk, which is at the Baltic Sea. It's now in Poland. It used to be German. Okay, and the French and the Prussians and the Russians around it. Okay, so I'm going to make this dancing, okay? Around it, and there's a siege, and the siege lasts 11 months. This is a very serious thing. And this is actually the end of the Napoleonic War, okay? In 1812, over to 1812, we hear it every 4th of July, okay? He goes, Napoleon leaves Russia, he goes over to Beresina, and then loses a lot of troops, he raises some new troops, and he comes back to fight some more. Okay, but we really know it's ultimately all over. So, okay, so why is the Jew actually spying for the French? What is the significance of that? Because matter of fact, in terms of history, the Lithuanian and the Polish Jews were not supporting the French. They were supporting the Russians. They know which side their bread was buttered on. If they were supporting the French, they knew there would be pogroms afterwards. They would not dare support Napoleon. Of course not. That's ridiculous. Okay, so there's a mistake here. Why would Turgenev make that mistake?
The Jew is painted as doing anything for money. And my assumption was that the French, Polish people were paying him more. That's the whole cliche about him. He'll sell his daughter.
But we don't know that. Mm-hmm. And we know that at this point, he's very engaged and he's really drawing this. He is in it. He's emotionally invested in this, in getting these maps done, because the maps are done very beautifully. The maps are done very carefully and they're very precise. What is the connection between the French and the Jews?
Would the reader have made the leap to think that the Jew was helping the French because Napoleon emancipated the Jews?
That's right. Yeah. There was always the fear. That was the fear. That was the cliche of the Russian. That was the Russian cliche that the Jews would naturally help Napoleon because Napoleon had promised emancipation of the Jew, so that the soul of the Jew would be with Napoleon because they were repressed. Okay, now, I will tell you what did it for me, that opened the story for me. We are reading the story as Jews, that's why we're upset. Okay? That's not who was reading the story. You would have to now switch mentally, okay? Read the story as a Russian. You have to read the story now, you have to turn around, and you have to read the story as a Russian. Forget that you're Jews. You're Russians now. You don't like Jews. You've never liked Jews. You don't even know Jews, but you know you don't like them. Okay, because they're staying in a state, they're so foreign, they do everything for money, they prostitute their daughters, and the whole, everything that you said, they're internationalists, they can't be relied on, they are weak, they are cowards, they are cunning, whatever you have in the story. Okay, now, you're reading this as a Russian. Okay, we have to look at the end. Let's go look at the beginning. Who's telling the story? No. Of course not, because it's not telling the story. The author writes the story and publishes it. Tell us a story. All right. Good. That's good. Okay.
It's not just.
What kind of guy is that? Yes.
He's not just a girl. He's a very affable.
In a card game. From a card shop. Whom he cheats.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That reference, and everybody, every Russian reader would have known that reference, does something to your understanding of Nikolai that you need to read him at two different levels. That guy is not as innocent as he is. Remember when we go to Leskov, which will be in about 5 minutes, we need to read everything on two different levels. Okay, so our Nikita, our Nikolai, has this kind of a face that on the surface looks beautiful and trustworthy and is everything Russian that it could possibly be, but when you look underneath and you follow the reference to Lermontov, you see that that beautiful Russian face is capable of quite a few things.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So the story unfolds, and we understand that the Jew is leering, da-da-da, and he's timorous, and he's a lovely creature, and all of that, and let's go skip to the end. And at the end, the Jew is caught. Good. The Jew is caught, and then what happens?
The colonel intervenes.
Yes, and in fact, he intervenes three times, which to Christian readers is like Pilatus. No, what's his name? Pilatus. That's his name. Pilate. Pontius Pilatus. I only know this guy in German. Okay, Pilatus is gymnastics or something like that. Okay, so this guy, the Roman guy, also a foreigner. Here we have who? Who is the guy who wants to nail this, hang this Jew? A German. It's a German, okay? And our nice Russian is so kind-hearted that he wants to interfere. And he does it three times, just as Jesus was as mercy was asked for him three times, and it was denied by the Jews. All right, and in this case, so we have the German, and the German sticks to the letter of the law. So we have an opposition between grace and the law, and the Jewish tongue. So now, what happens at the hanging? And this is one of the standard interpretations of that story. And this is why I'm asking you if you were shaken by the ending. Because Russian readers were.
They were?
Yeah, Russian readers were shaken by the ending because it humanizes the Jew. Because all of a sudden, you don't see the stereotypes. You see somebody grotesquely frightened. I mean, grotesquely frightened. Mm-hmm. And in a way, whatever he was before, you feel sorry for him. And so one of the standard interpretations of this story is that Turgenev takes all of the cliches that are so familiar to Russians from reading Gogol and makes them even sharper and gets you to believe all of this because, yes, we have the story of the prostitution of the daughter, and then he tops it up by offering the daughter's integrity for if his own life was saved, and then he's being hung and he's absolutely reduced to total suffering, and that turned people around and said, well, yeah, whatever I thought of him before, you know, he's also just a human being. That too is a cliche. We know it from Shylock. Or Shakespeare used that. Mm-hmm. Okay.
We're letting Turgenev off too easy.
Oh, right, exactly. We do.
Because there is this element in the story that the colonel was manipulated by the father into falling in love with the daughter by withholding her favors repeatedly, by making him even more attracted to her, by making her come back each time. He may have been trying to save her virtue while he was cheating the colonel, but as a result, the colonel really falls for her. So it's as though the colonel was manipulated by the clever Jew into having feelings for the daughter.
I do not believe that colonel has any feelings, and I feel very supported by Leskov in not thinking that. I think that colonel is just desirous, but not in love.
But desirous enough for him to...
I don't believe that for 1 second.
But why did he intervene?
Okay, before that, you see, this is already his second rescue. Before that, there was another rescue. There was a pogrom, and the soldiers wanted to take all the property, and the daughter comes, and because he already knows and says, please help me, and he goes, and he sees in what reduced circumstances they live, and to what an ugly woman, also a type there, with the chickens, and the mother comes out, and one time the mother actually makes an appearance, and he intervenes, so just you cannot take anything from there, and she is very thankful, and then she says, I will come to you in the morning. She said, I will come to you, and he says, will you come in the evening? He says, no, I will come in the morning, which means this is a different thing, this is of her own volition. So we are looking at a totally different setup. In this case, it's already a softening of the stereotypes is occurring to prepare us for the reversal at the end. That would be one way of dealing with it, John.
I think there's something also, the colonel is sort of a coward, in that he has to go to the general to get forgiveness or to so his character is not impugned, and he's putting it on the Jew, when in fact it was his doing it. Because I think it was his underling who reported on him, his foot soldier or something like that was reporting on this.
There is something not quite right about the relationship between the colonel and the German. The German appears to be a stand-in for something, and yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Russians read the German as a screen for the Tsar, because the Tsar was actually descended from the House of Oldenburg. A Grand Duchess of the Romanovs had actually married into a German house. So it was considered that the current Tsar, Alexander, was actually a German, also in love with all of this. And that is why the censor wouldn't release it. He felt there was a kind of insubordination of an enlightened, soft-hearted person against the autocracy, against the tough laws, because against the Jews issued by the government. You can already see that we resent that the soldiers are coming in, even as Russians coming in and just to basically take the property of the Jews. We already feel that that's not quite right. So the story was read as a political story because the Russians were trained, because of censorship, to read everything between the lines. And it was read as almost a form of insubordination. And that German was read as a symbol. We're no longer attuned to this kind of sensitivity because we're not living under censorship. But that was one of the offerings. And then I have one more interpretation. Luis, would you? Oh, no. Yeah, sorry, Sandy.
I just wanted to say the story was told by the colonel, but the coronet had just been promoted. He was a young, inexperienced soldier. And
right.
I didn't think that the Jew was humanized in the end except by the love of his wife and his daughter. It wasn't his cowardice that they soldiers would interpret.
Uh-huh.
That would be the stereotype of the Jew. It would be a coward rather than a spy who admitted he was a spy. All of that. So
that is a possibility. I'm just gonna now offer my final thought and then we will go to the more complex story by Reskov, which is okay, so the guy's name is Nikolai. Nikolai Ilyich, a very general, Ilyich is a very general name. There's nothing could be, that's like being called Smith. I hope no one's called Smith, but it's like Smith or Johnson or something like that. Okay, in 1843, I want to say, my last thing was 1838, when Turgenev was studying in Germany, he went for a boat trip. And he was in Lübeck, which is a city on the Baltic Sea, just like Danzig. And he was boarded on a ship with the name Nikolai,
mm-hmm.
Nikolai I, and the ship caught fire. And Turgenev made a scene. He was screaming his head off. He was just like reacting to the threat of death, just like this Jew who was being hanged there. And he was making not only a scene, he had to be restrained by the captain. He was making a rush for the lifeboats. He was shoving away women and children in order to get saved. And rumor of that, because it was known that he was a nobleman, rumor of his unmanly behavior made it into Russia and dogged him his entire life. His brother wrote him a scathing letter, our Irina Petrovna, a scathing letter. We know that you are fat. And of course, a fat man always has issues. You can nothing do. You cannot help it that you're fat. But your unmanly behavior, that is really beyond the pale. I mean, no pun intended. So the story is also being read as begging, and this is why it is so important that the humanizing of this Jew happens at the end. He behaves in an effeminate way. He behaves unmanly. He behaves like a coward. He makes a scene. He is utterly grotesque, and that is precisely the way Turgenev was himself. So he identifies with that, and what he wants to happen is that we still have pity on this human being. So that's my fourth interpretation. So that is another reading of the story. That's how complex the stuff can get. Yes, go ahead.
But it's just mind-boggling to me that, as you say, if only 800,000 people, less than 1% of the entire population was reading, okay? So that they couldn't grasp that this portrayal of their own society was so horrifyingly awful that they couldn't see how awful the colonel was. I mean, no matter what you thought of him.
He looks so good. He's so gentle. He is so Russian. And he's so
mean. And that they could not understand that as a complete condemnation of themselves, their society, of how they were living.
It's very difficult for us, 150 years later, living in American freedom and plenty, to imagine, and this is why we're doing this exercise for literature. You can read history books and you'll never imagine. But you have to put yourself into Russian shoes And if you are growing up, and I have the same story of Nazi Germany, I couldn't see that they were drinking the juice all over. If you're growing up in a society, and this is the standard, and this is all you know, and that's all you read, and we had a conversation about reading Gogol.
No, I get that.
That is all.
But this is being written by a guy who, as you said, is extremely wealthy. All right?
Right.
And he's not confined to Russia.
And
he's traveling with his wife through France.
That's right.
At a time when France was relatively liberal, that he doesn't have the sensitivity to try and open the eyes of his own people.
So the argument would be that this story is trying to do precisely this. You will never convince somebody if you write, let's say, a story representing a heroic Jew. Let's say if you write a story about Moses Mendelssohn and how awesome he is. That is not how you will be.
Well, I'm taking the Jew out of it. I'm not even focusing on the Jew.
But we were taking it as an example. Let me make this example. You need, when you are talking to people who are stuck in an ideological rut, you have to speak their language. And this story is speaking a Russian language that is very familiar. Everybody knows this type. And at the very end, in one, you can always make only just one tiny teaching point per story. Mm-hmm. And at the very end, it sucks it to them by humanizing the Jew. So that is what he's trying to do in the story.
But even granting you that, which I'm not sure, but even granting you that.
Well, I'm just making this argument.
Even granting that. Humanizing the Jew in some very, very small extent doesn't, at the same time, equal a condemnation of some sort of your own society.
But you can't, but he was voting, what more can he do? He was voting with his feet. He moved, he left Russia in 1856 for good, and he never to return.
All the more freedom you, I'm sorry, I don't want to argue with you, but all the more freedom you have.
The story is written in 1846.
All the more freedom you have under those circumstances to be even more condemnatory.
Are you finding fault for him for not being a revolutionary?
No, it's not being a revolutionary. I mean, take it on its own terms. Even if you think the Jews are awful people, then why are you going after a Jewess? I mean, why are you doing that? What does that say about
you? Probably 67 million people who couldn't read were learning from the church or from their officers through stories. And I think that's the point he was making, that these stereotypes are propagated not by people reading, but by people in the church or in the army.
You cannot, when a society is so much stuck as Russian society, when it is ruled by secret police, when you have no possibility of publishing anything freely in the Russian language anywhere in Russia that does not go through a censor, you have to be very careful. And this was a society in the intelligentsia, and we're just, Turgenev is only one, he's one of the more conservative ones. Radicalism is just starting. Herzen, for example, Alexander Herzen, had to leave Russia, lived in London, and was issuing a journal called The Bell. Radicalism is beginning now. People are very sensitive to that. In fact, when Alexander II offered not just to dictate to the landowners that serfdom would now be abolished, but invited them to think about various means, landowners picked it up and did come up with proposals to how serfdom can be abolished. This rethinking that you want to see is happening. We're just reading only with one story. We're moving on to Liskov now. Money is very important. Okay, I want you to have the feel of kopecks. Okay, because kopecks are very important, and they are from 1878 and from some other years. That is what a three kopeck piece is. A kopeck piece looks like. It's very big. This was a lot of money type kopecks. Do you remember Dostoevsky only gets a quarter kopeck? So I'm gonna let you handle this old Russian money. I love physical stuff. Let's go to Leskov. Check my time here. We'll spend a little bit of time, and we're gonna spend the last half hour on Dostoevsky. Okay, Leskov. Okay. In August 1883, he dies in 89. I cannot forgive myself for never having acquired a French language to the point where I could work in it like my native tongue. I would leave Russia once and forever. Would that satisfy you? Okay. All right. In his later stories, and this is the one that we'll be reading, discussing now, Deception. The public doesn't like them, these stories, because they are cynical and in your face. But I don't want to please the public. I want to torture it and flog it. Okay? So that, we need to figure out how the stereotype is handled. Just a very quick run through about where we are. He wrote, we're in the middle part of the six stories that he wrote about, I'm going to skip all that he wrote about the Jews. This is our man just before he died. He grew up, Svatikov, go back to thinking about Gospoda Golovyovi. You remember Alina Petrovna, how she moved from the state of Golovyovo, and she moved to Dobrinovo, Dobrinovo, whatever it was called. The middle one, and then he moved to Little Pagarete. That was Liskov, okay? He started out on an estate, and he came to be in great, great, great poverty. The way he lost his place at the estate was, he was too good in German, and the German teacher praised him. He was actually there as a poor relative and was raised with all the other kids on the estate. And the German teacher said, oh, you're really very talented, and the relatives got very jealous, and he had to leave. And it was all spiraling down. He got a job in Kiev, in the conscription office, and then he got another job. He didn't really like that, and then he got a job in an English company, also through a relative, and he got to travel all over Russia. And he learned Polish, and he learned Ukrainian, and he was a man of the people. He loved observing folks, and he picked up a lot of the ethnographic details, and he wrote a great, and he became a journalist. He did investigative journalism. And intelligentsia absolutely hated him because they figured he was on the right. He was also a man of the church. He comes from a long line of clergy.
Intelligentsia.
I'm sorry?
Intelligentsia.
Oh, tell.
Intelligentsia really didn't like him. He thought he was a total right winger. But he just was very pretty kind of guy. He was anti-Semite for sure, because that sort of comes with being fond of the church. And the first stories, 1877, 1878, and 1882, are very nasty. And they're not redeemable. And then something happens, okay? He goes to St. Petersburg. He's a famous journalist already. And Ginsburg, a big banker, shows up and says, we got a problem. We have the Parliament Commission, and you got to think about what to do with the Jews, because the laws are just not kind of working. And we need someone who is not Jewish. We need someone to write what about the Jews and why the emancipation is going to happen. And he says, okay, he was a very poor guy. I'm sure he was paid. Nobody knows he was paid. This was really under the table. And he writes the essay that you read. And what's your reaction on the question of the Jews? 1883, he writes that. It was published anonymously in only 50 copies because it was that explosive. In 50 copies, and was not discovered until 1919. We did not know about that because it was only distributed to the members of the Talon Committee. That was one of those, I'm worried, the 50th committee to think about the question of the Jews. Stunning.
He makes two key arguments. He argues in the alternative.
Yeah.
First of all, if the Jews really are as bad as you say, how does that make them worse than all the other ethnicities that you don't complain about? But the real heart of his argument is that how do you expect them to be otherwise when you have treated them this way? You have boxed them into a corner where this is the only way they can function.
Right.
And given the fact that you've done this to them, they actually provide you with valuable services.
Right, and that goes, and that, not to interrupt you, but I will, and that goes to the last story about Solomon, which is very, very clever, okay? Mm-hmm. So the argument about how can it hurt if a Christian girl is working for the Jews? A, they're poor themselves, they work all the time, you wouldn't even want that job, and then if you have the job, you know, they're good to you. It's a good thing. And the Christians who are living in the Pale, they have a better moral status than the rest of us. You're accusing the Jews of running the taverns and making intoxicated. Look at the history of drunkenness in Russia. Okay? The most important argument that he actually makes, and that is also very important about Turgenev, the Russians were afraid that the Jews would economically hurt the Christians and that they would become so powerful that they would take over. Those were the two fears, okay? And that's why Turgenev's story is also important, because it shows a totally powerless, ridiculous Jew. What are you guys afraid of, he's saying to the Russians. And the same argument is made by Leskov, the Jews are not an economic threat. It's a little bit contradictory. And where they're doing, and where they're in the Pale, people are benefiting by them. So, you know, he's trying to have his cake and eat it too, but he takes every single argument that is out there in the committee, why the Jews should not be granted equal rights, and he says it is completely ridiculous. And then he says, why are you torturing the Belarusians and the Ukrainians? Why are you putting all the Jews in their territory? It's true that, you know, why are you going to poison them? And this is real, this is tongue-in-cheek Leskov, okay? Why are you going to poison and punish the Ukrainians and the Belarusians by putting 4 million Jews into their territory? Spread them out. Spread the poison out. And then you will make it, you know, you neutralize it. So he takes every conceivable anti-Jewish argument and explodes it. And there is no such thing, no such essay anywhere in the history of Russian writing on the Jews. It's an extraordinary essay. You know, even though it might not live up to snuff, we would like it to be a little bit more modern and all of that, but that's as good as it gets. And the essay, having to think about this essay and having to make these arguments, really did something to Leskov. And he completely changed his tune. It actually taught himself something. And the stories after that, his 3 more stories on the Jews, are actually very soft in a certain way. And one of them is Deception, that we will be talking about now. He has the story here about the tale of Theodore the Christian and his friend Abram the Jew. Is very similar almost the same story. It's very similar to Nathan the Wise by Lessing. And even though Leskov was poor, to the end of his life, he made sure that this story, which was about tolerance, about the friendship between a Jew and a Christian, was published in a mass publication and distributed at a very low cost. That's how he came to rue what he had done before. Okay. Deception. Now, if you're thinking about the rapacious Jew we saw in the rapacious Russian, the lecherous Russian, which is really, I think, what one needs. It's also a stereotype, by the way, of the story, of Turgenev's story. We meet a completely different type, worse type here. So what's with this one? Deception. What do you make of that? I think it's very clever. I fell in love with Leskov with that story. Okay, what's your reaction to that? I know it's very hard to keep all the stories straight, but right? After a while it is all boom, and then you have all of Dostoevsky, and it gets really, okay, can somebody just give the content of what's going on there? Where are we? Okay, yeah, go ahead.
It's the one where they think she's a beautiful lady and they're going to woo her into an adulterous relationship, but it turns out that she's just a town girl.
He already ruined the whole thing, I can tell. Okay.
I assumed everybody read it.
Yeah. Okay. That's it?
Should we do the same thing? Well, okay, let's
talk about something. That was just to remind people. Okay, so the first story was 1847. We are 40 years on, okay? And in fact, in 1881, what happens?
New Salem.
1881, what happens, guys?
The serfs?
The serfs.
Okay, this is our Alex. He's dead. Okay? I don't want you to really have to look at a dead guy. But, okay, in 1881, he dies. And then what happens before? Well, that's this is our guy, the next guy, so we really want to go get
the Jews. The Jews' situation changes for the worse.
Okay, we got pogroms after Wazoo. It's really bad. It is really bad. And 2 million and 2 million Jews will leave for here. It's really understood now that the situation in Russia will not change. And there's no other thing now, either you become a Zionist or you go to America. Okay, so that's what happens. And in 1883, he writes this story, which has another Jew in it. But the Jew is not so important here. The Jew is also a panderer. In the same function we saw him before, he's also a mercenary and he's also there with the money. Well, that's what's good about this? I mean, we can do just a guess here. I'm just being smitten by the literary cleverness of this story.
Well, it's talking about how commonplace adultery was with the soldiers.
Yeah.
It's not a pretty picture of provincial Russian society.
Right. This is a story, this goes to you, okay, to your comment, that is critical of the Russians. Right? This is like Saltykov. This is holding a mirror up to this form of behavior. We again have an invasion of Moldova in this case. The Russians are there as protectors. They were actually throwing out whom? The Turks. Were there, okay, and the Russians are coming in. Okay, so what's the expectation here? What's actually happening right at the beginning? Because we're meeting another very nice Russian. I mean, I don't see why you guys don't like this guy. Devoted, okay, which is a solicitude and looks good and is a colonel and certain retired army officer.
He's deflecting the focus from the Jews onto the Romanians.
Right, okay, so he says, you know, there's people who are worse than the Jews and those other Romanians, okay, and then he tells a story that turned out to be the most important story of his army life. Why? Because at the end he's fired. Did you realize that? He loses his job. He has to leave the army. At the very end, it will tell us that he has to leave the army. Okay. I had betrayed dishonorably. I had betrayed a lady. And they demanded that I leave the regiment. He has to leave the regiment. So this is why this is crucial. The event here is crucial. Why is the story called Deception and who's deceiving whom? And who is this guy? What do we know about this guy?
I think one deception is the self-deception. This officer thinks he's such a Lothario.
Exactly. The entire thing is based on self-deception. Good. Characterize this guy for me a little bit. What do you know about him? You're given the key in the first paragraph. By the end of chapter one, you know everything about this guy you need to know. What's his behavior? First of all, it's very interesting. This takes place in a railway car. Railway cars are very important situations now for telling stories. You are on the go. Things are changing. It's a symbol of things changing. Okay, he's sitting in a railway car. He looks like a retired officer. He hasn't been an officer in a very long time. It is astounding that he's holding on to that. That he's left to be the regiment. He only has only like a little bit left. But they identify him as a retired. No, I know, sacked officer would be better. A retired officer. Okay, so what's his behavior? Okay. Actually, very interesting. I thought at least would be picking up on that. Okay. The old man was white-haired as Nestor, looks a little bit like Turgenev, and muscular as Samson before he got shorn by Delilah. Okay. Before he got shorn. That means, okay, we are shorn for his shearing. The she's shearing will be happening. In this story, he is shorn. He loses his power. He loses everything he's got. He's sacked. Just like Samson, he is destroyed at the end. And you will be witnessing that he's destroyed by his own vanity. Mm-hmm. Just like you said, by his own self-deception, because he came to be so important, so in love with himself, that he doesn't see what's going on all around him. Okay, what's the first thing this guy does? He's deceiving.
He spreads out his.
Right. Okay. And what is with the pillows? And what's with the pillows?
It makes it look as though there are other passengers.
That's right. They are. He was planning that. Okay. He is so selfish. So selfish. He takes three best seats and he makes three different pillows. So they looked at just sort of belong to three different babushkita right there who are sitting there. Okay. So he is. This is the first act of deception. And it goes on and on and on and on and on. Okay. Everything is double. The lady deceives him. The Jew is the only one who does not deceive him. He delivers the goods, does he not? It's just that the guy can't see it. That's not the Jew's fault, which is why he wants to have his other ruble, which he wants to see whatever it is. Are you following? You're looking at me very puzzled, like I just said something really extremely stupid. Okay, so that is actually very interesting. The Jew is a minor figure, but he's the one who delivers the goods. Too bad the guy can't see it, because the woman is in disguise. But if you had, I mean, you wouldn't be able to tell a young woman from an old woman if you had your, you were really thinking clearly and really looking. He isn't even looking, because he's so involved with himself. Okay, and so at the end, you can go, I mean, if you read the story and you are attuned to deception, and you are looking for deception, there is no one thing. That is right. Very interesting, by the way, are the many, many allusions to Hebrew Bible, to our Tanakh. It begins with the sentiment Delilah, and then at some point he complains about the birds, that there are too many herons, Pharaoh's bird, and he never likes it when they multiply. Why is that? Because things make him think of the plague and so on, because those birds symbolize, obviously, the prosperity was a very, very important Egyptian bird. Okay, so here, I can't endure it. Wherever that bird of Pharaoh multiplies, it has something about it that reminds me of all the Egyptian plagues. Okay, of course, because he too will be exploited, just like the Jews in Egypt. And there are many, many, many wonderful allusions. It's a very well-crafted story. So what is the point at the very end? What happens? It's just as a form of craftsmanship, it's extraordinary.
It's the job as the governor of a little Jewish town.
Oh, yeah, right, and he gets to be governor, and he behaves just in the way before. Remember, he's boxing the Jews around the ears because he doesn't want to pay them. Okay, so that too, those are the kinds of governors the Russians are putting into Jewish towns. That too, sir, in the back, is a criticism of the way the Russians behave toward the Jews. So the criticism is there, but because of censorship, you can't come right outright and say it. But if you have this character who becomes a governor of a Jewish town, I mean, that is as outspoken as you can possibly be. Yes, dear.
Okay, what I got from this story is the massive lies that everyone is lying to everyone.
Through that.
Everyone is hating by ethnic groups. That Russian hates Ukrainians, Moldovan, the Jews, the kind of everyone, and the Russians are superior, what they think. And that's what I got from this story. And about censorship, I just want to say, when I read about Dostoevsky's life and Saltykov-Shchedrin, that came to in the biography, that they both belong to Petrashevsky Obshchestvo. It's like a group of people. They were just intellectuals. They were not making revolution, nothing. And in, I think it's in 1849, Dostoevsky was sent to prison and lost all belongings and everything. And it's a group of intellectuals. A group of people who talked about enlightening the society, and that's how the censorship is so crucial for Russians. Not only at that time, and much, much later, that was the same. You cannot say because even something will, what Suzanne said, reading between lines. And if something will interpret what you are saying between lines,
absolutely,
you know, that's cause your everything.
Right. I think that's a very important point, that the story is about that there is no possibility of establishing the truth unless you look very, very carefully. The problem with this officer is that he's very poorly educated. You can tell from all the references that he makes. He alludes to, before we had a reference to an Turgenev, it was a reference to Lermontov. Here we don't have a reference to Lermontov. We have a reference to some guy, Kurganov, who issued a primer, a reading book, a book of text for schools. That is the kind of level of education that we have. That too is a criticism. These are the people who we are promoting to officers. These are the people who we're putting in charge. What happened to the intelligentsia? This is as wicked a criticism of Russian society as you're likely to get anywhere. And this is why, I mean, Leskov was not mincing words, and he was to the end of his life, and that was what he decided to do: flog society, give it to them. He was very aggressive about that, and I think that is a picture of deciding society more disheartening than you get it in Saltykov. Mm. Very critical. And the ending that he wants to best this Moldovan, first of all, trying to get things for free, right? Being a total freeloader. I just gave the 50 rubles to your wife, and he gets to be white as a sheet, because if that is not done, even if it were true, one wouldn't say that. And it turns out, obviously not his wife, because he couldn't really look, couldn't read the signs. Very interesting that his friend kills himself, because he feels so humiliated, because he doesn't have the money. So there are alternatives. So overall, it's an extraordinary, extraordinary story, and it's very well, really well crafted. Okay, we have 20 minutes for Dostoevsky. Sorry about that. Okay, but you know what? This is not a course about Dostoevsky. This is a course about Russia and the Jews. So there's really only one Jewish character in there, so we should be able to do this very quickly. So, Zhenya, since you love Dostoevsky so much, would you start us off and just talk a little bit about you and Dostoevsky and how do Russians react to Dostoevsky and the Jews? And you're obviously Jewish, so what's this? Tell us a little bit. Something.
It's a subject for long conversation.
Good, but you have 1 minute.
Yes. So it's two interesting things. First, Dostoevsky was not really published before Stalin died. So although he was Russia filled, and that he was considered too controversial.
Too conservative?
I think conservative and controversial, because there are so many things. This book is not part of, first, it's not very popular. Second one, this book only few people read, really. I think that the Crime and Punishment is the, in school literature, everybody read it. Mm-hmm. Karamazov Brothers read
so
everything.
Crime and Punishment, because, much later, so 1866.
Yeah, that's something, that's, as I mentioned, school problem. This book broadly reflects his own recollection of being in the prison. I just want to make a couple of comments. I read it first time, and obviously in Russian. So I think it's wonderful gallery of characters. Amazing. I don't even remember where it has. I've seen so many faces, and they vary their life. And the second one, which I don't know, you're probably not going to talk about, reading that, I thought, wow, if you compare this prison with the Russian, with Soviet Gulag, it's almost like in a sanatorium.
Yes.
Yeah, if you read the, the Solzhenitsyn, these people walk fed. And they could buy additional food and bring wine, vodka, and it just looks...
All right, but we are talking Siberia, and we are talking a house like that. I think, nothing.
We read one day from Life of Ivan Denisovich.
Okay, this is the branding tool. I mean, in Gulag, at least you were not branded. This is the branding tool. And this is actually, here you can see the bicolored uniform. This is actually Shimon Tukhachevsky. who was a fellow prisoner and who actually wrote a book in which this is in Polish. Katorgi is the penal servitude. Katorga we also have in Russian, yes. The penal servitude, Szymanto Karszewski, this was actually a first edition, which I don't own, but it was online to see. And this is the half-shaved head, okay, the bicolored uniform, and there would be a black circle on the back. And I think the real cruel thing is really the branding, and the Jew too gets branded. And this is the way people lived. I'm not so sure that it was so. And this is actually what Tobolsk looks like now. You remember there was a transition camp? So you were marching. And then you came to Tobolsk. And then he was there for 10 days. And so now it's actually a tourist attraction. It's also somewhere in Siberia, not too far from Omsk. And then from there you went to Omsk. And this is a, even have, I'm sorry that that's so dark now. Getty images. They have a sculpture of Dostoevsky in Tobolsk, even though he was there only 10 days, but it's just like a very significant guy for them. Okay, so we're back to Omsk. Now, let's start on making sense of this. Yeah, Beverly.
I have Tashnik. I asked you why you had selected this book.
Yes.
There's one character, and he really has one page
right.
That's devoted to him. And I want. No, and you gave me your enigmatic smile. Do you want to talk about why you selected?
Yeah. First of all, it is the first. I think it is an extraordinary literary work. I agree with Virginia that.
I agree. But this is
yeah.
Of course, the Jews.
Well, I feel that we need to know one of the greatest writers before he turns total Judeophobe. I think that if you are looking at the line of. Descriptions of Jews that we just read from Turgenev in 1847 to Leskov at the very end, which is a real, I would almost say, in a swamp of deception, the one honest guy who delivers the goods is almost like a positive image, and we had the essay before. The middle ground would be held by Dostoevsky in the 1860s, 40s, 60s, 80s. I wanted to give you a development. It's also really the first literary, really great literary work produced by Dostoevsky on account of the extraordinary descriptions and on account of the exquisite structuring, which you cannot work out, but which you can work out yourself when you write down what are the individual chapters and how they are relating to each other. And then, of course, we have the figure of Isai Fomich Bumstein. I guess that's how you say him in Russian. Bumstein, that's a really ugly name. But there was one Jew there at Bumstein, and even though people say it's based, the portrait that Dostoevsky drew is based on this figure, this character who was there, I think not. I think at that point, Dostoevsky too, Dostoevsky had started his literary career trying to write a play about Taras Bulba. And it was called Yankel the Jew. And so Yankel the Jew is also in this character of Isai Fomich, who appears a few times. And my question to you is now that you know Leskov and now that you know Turgenev, what are you making of Isai Fomich? What kind of a character is he? What is he, what's he using there? What is Dostoevsky on his way to Judeophobia? And that's why we have Kovner, I gave you Kovner to read. Kovner, pitiful Jew that he was, okay, attacked, stole the money, went to prison, wrote in prison, nothing much to do, in 1877, a letter to Dostoevsky in which he has two things to say. A, you suck up the Jews, you really got to think about them because the Jews are not that way. And two, can you help me get my stuff published? How crazy is that? Okay. All right, so here we have Kovner already all done. Okay, so, and I wanted to show you what the reality of Jewish life was then, which is very far, as Jabotinsky says, very far from the reality of, from the perception of the Russians of Jews. There's just no overlap at all. So Jabotinsky is right. If you look at Kovner's life and you try to square that with the portrait of the Jews, there's no match. It's just not, just no, nothing going. Okay, Fomich, Isai, do something. And what do we have here? Where does he pop up? he gets, he's, even has a chapter heading. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what's with him? What does, why is Dostoevsky putting him there? What does Dostoevsky do with him? What do we already, what are we already familiar with? What struck you? You can go to this. It's chapter 9, I believe. Chapter 9 in part 1.
It seemed like a stereotype of a Hasidic Jew, very sort of off, but that was the sort of whirling dervish, dancing around,
right,
crying so when he prayed.
Right. So Dostoevsky is actually fascinated by the ritual. That's one thing. We haven't seen any praying Jews yet, okay? But he makes a lot of mistakes, does he not?
It's very odd.
Yeah, okay. First of all, the phylacteries have, the tefillin has three pieces, which we don't. Maybe we just rub one in the course of an education in America, but as far as I know, it's only one, two, right? Just wrap the straps. I mean, I'm not wearing when I'm a girl, so Okay, now there's a knot in the back. Okay, so yeah, the tefillin, maybe because that's a knot, another part. Okay, they have three pieces by here. Okay, he wears a talis on Friday night. Well, I guess we don't. Right? I mean, you can if you're an American, but in the old days we didn't. You, on Shabbos morning, sure. You know, for chakras, you cover yourself. But tefillin are not worn on Shabbos morning. We don't wear tefillin on Shabbos. Okay, so he makes several mistakes describing the ritual. Okay, so that is one thing. What does he do? So we're on page 1, if you have this edition, on page 142. That's where it starts, I think.
Do you have Torah in 36?
Yeah. Oh, that's the Bath. All right, 136. That's right. Because I think the Bath is beyond anything. The Bath is like purgatory. It's like hell. It's like Dante. It's like it's extraordinary. And there is a parallel scene to that in a book by Linetsky, Joel Linetsky. It's called Das Polnische Jingo. And there is a portrait of a bath that is just like that. I actually recommend that book to you. You can buy it online. You can only buy it Linetsky. Why actually? Das Polnische Jingo, and there's a bath scene in it that is very similar, 1867. And it's available in English. Okay, so that's that. So what else does he do? Come on, a little bit more. You're very good now at this. You know your stereotypes. What's happening?
He charges
this.
Right.
I'm sorry?
He charges
in. Yeah, okay, so he comes in and we already know, but let's look at that. So how does he come in? What does Dostoevsky do here? 37, 36. It's his first day, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, the first thing we know, he's laughable. He's ridiculous, yes? He's a laughable guy. The bliss was a brilliantly blissful face of Isaiah Fomich. How comical and laughable he was. Okay, 50-ish, puny, wrinkled, horrible brands on his cheeks. I just showed him to you on forehead. Skinny, feeble, white body like a plucked chicken. We have to pluck the chicken here again. Mm-hmm. Expression on his face revealed unwavering, unshakable self-satisfaction and even beatific happiness. How all these things come together, I don't know. He felt apparently not the slightest regret at having fallen into prison since he was a jeweler. There was no other one in town. He was able to spend all his time and so on. Okay, and the town's Jews didn't deny him their protection friendship. Okay, so we have solidarity. But that's not really what's important here. Yeah.
He says that he's an employer.
Yeah, privileges.
He gets an armed guard to take him to the synagogue.
Yeah, there's freedom of religion.
Yeah, freedom of religion. Yeah. Okay, so you know, yeah, I can go show, I guess, if you want to. A silver ruble, and he's very timid. But the very moment when he's giving something to deal with, he wakes up. Mm-hmm. Okay, so yeah, that's who he is. He's a guy who was a wheel dealer. And he feels comfortable, and we already begin to like him. And everybody likes him. Astonishing. Okay? Everybody says Dostoevsky. I'm not saying that is so. But in Dostoevsky's concept, everybody likes this Jew.
But it seems that he writes about him with sympathy. It's very clear.
I'm sorry?
He writes about him with sympathy.
He writes about him with sympathy.
That's the feeling which I got.
Right.
Understand the
You know, this entire world, I have to tell you, is really screwed up. Yeah. I mean, if you are being made to feel sympathy or liking for a guy like Gazan who likes to kill children, that's a screwball world. If you are constantly confronted with men who are made heroic, courageous, brave, great friends, who killed their captains, their wives, and God knows what. I mean, the nicest thing they're doing is actually smuggling. But these are killers. Mm-hmm. These are killers who feel no remorse. Mm-hmm. It said two times in the books, these are not people who have any conscience, any empathy, don't feel anything. What we're dealing with here, we're dealing with a literary conception, okay? What is really important is to see this description of the guys in connection with Dostoevsky's philosophy of crime as a condition of being human. And that even you remember that every crime, a murder is not quite a murder, it's not always a murder. It depends on who the killer is and why he's doing it. And even if two killers, I'm talking Dostoevsky, that's not my opinion. I just want to make absolutely clear for eternity, this is not my opinion.
Get that on tape.
When he says, when the same amount of years are given for as punishment for a crime, or the same number of floggings, of strokes, it's not the same. This is not just. This is not justice. Because it is received by individuals in a very different fashion. 50 for one is the same as 5,000 for another. That is why he gives us so many different types in order to show how each person, and you're a professional at that, how each person receives and does things differently. So this is the beginning of his extreme individualism. You need to look at a human being, and you can only assess who someone is if something is a crime, if you enter into that person's mind. And he says at some point in the book, when I first came and I already to this prison and I already thought I knew everything, that's not so. I learned, it says at the very end, only at the very, toward the end, after a long time, I learned to really see who these people were. It took me a long time, and he talks all the time of trying to find his way into this society, trying to position himself, and that means he needs to think about who he himself is and how does he fit into humanity that is totally depraved. But for him, that is how people really are when you see them without their costumes. That is the essence of humanity, is that people are capable of that and not feeling remorse. It's an intense look, and you picked up exactly right. It's an intense look at the essence of human beings and how many different variants are there of being reduced to that sort of disgusting thing. Okay, and in that mess of humanity, I'm citing Reb Gardner's words again, when he was saying, you know, we clean up our closets and you only keep only the beautiful things. Nothing of this book would remain. Maria Kolo, or whatever her name was. And he says, no, but we've got to live with the mess. And I was thinking of Dostoevsky as I was listening to Rabbi Gardner's words on Yom Kippur. This is what us all thrown out of the closet. This is the rubbish of humanity. But that's who we are, Dostoevsky says. Good. And in that rubbish heap, you see Isaiah Fomich. And now you see, if he can make a parasite and a child murderer and all of that into a positive empathic figure, the Jews, nothing. He can even do it to the Jews. Okay? Makes them empathic. The Jew fits in the gallery of decrepit people. Okay. Now, there's one moment that really, and I think then we have to close, there's one moment in which Isaiah Fomich is really, it's exactly 9:30, but I will finish the sentence, is really a human being. It is astonishing for him, for Dostoevsky, or for the narrator, and this is very close to Dostoevsky, the transformation is Christmas. for the Jew, the transformation, the transformative moment in which he is truly not grotesque but a human being, is when he's in the theater. So that is the, and that is actually the last thing he says about him. How astounding. And that is what really the description that you picked up on the Shabbos ritual is. It's a theater, it's a performance. The Jews love to perform. So even when he gives him the most humanity, he still sucks it to him because it's not honest, it's a theater. All right, with this, we are on to a great other, great new writer. In the back, please take a copy of Slavuta, which is a description of a murder case in a Hasidic community, written by a great Russian historian, Saul Ginsburg, who emigrated to the United States. You have two stories of Chekhov's that are also back there, and we will discuss Sholem Aleichem's railroad stories, which you need to buy as a book. And I'll see you November 9th. And on November 10, I hope I see many of you or all of you at Brett Stevens' talk here at Temple Emanuel.